Hey everybody! Today we want to start with a new chapter in our lecture, namely we want to look at statistics. When I say statistics, at least in the first couple of lectures, I really refer to the traditional frequentist kind of statistics, where we receive some data, typically a sample from an unknown distribution, and we want to learn to estimate, for example, some aspects about distribution, or we might want to test a hypothesis about this distribution. This is the kind of statistics that is very widely used in very many areas of science, like in the social sciences. You might have a hypothesis that two different populations, whether they behave similarly or not, this is something you might want to test. In the medical case, something that we are very aware of right now, if you want to test a new vaccine and you want to, first of all, maybe estimate how useful it is, and then maybe you want to test whether it is better than the null treatment of not giving a vaccine. These are all questions where we have a setup. There is an unknown ground truth distribution that generates our data. We observe samples and then we would want to do something with that. There's also a field of statistics that's called Bayesian statistics. We're going to talk about this later. It has a slightly different approach. So today we start looking at the very traditional approach. We're going to start with what is a statistical model, and then in this lecture look at estimation, in particular point estimation, and what is a bias and the variance of such an estimate. So let us get started. So the typical way the traditional statistics is being set up is that there is a family of distributions, and you assume that your data is generated by one of the members of this family, and you want to identify the correct, like the correct distribution in this family based on a sample that you have observed. Let me try to write this down at least slightly. So we assume that our data is generated by a particular family of distributions, So, for example, say I know my data is distributed according to a normal distribution. So typically we do, the way we do that is this family of distribution is being denoted by a curly letter, curly capital letter, so I call it F for family. And then the way this is typically being written up in an abstract way is, here we start maybe with a, for example, here I start with the example, we have a normal distribution with mu, mean mu, and variance sigma squared. And we know mu could be at some element in R, and sigma squared could be also some number larger than zero. Okay, so this is an assumption we need to make, and in traditional statistics, in most case, or in, at least in the parametric case, so this is not only traditional but the parametric view, we typically make such an assumption. And more generally, and this is now an example, but more generally, the way this is written up as follows. More generally, this family is typically typically denoted as follows. So we have this family still called F, and now we say it consists of a set of distributions F theta, so this is a lowercase Greek theta, where the theta is in some uppercase theta space of parameters. So this is a very abstract thing. So let me maybe try to denote it. This is the space of all possible parameters. And in the example we had above, it would be the set of the two parameters mu and sigma. So in to make our notation simpler, when we talk about any abstract statement without referring to a particular distribution, then this is what we call the theta. And now maybe here's a little side note I need to make. Thetas are a bit annoying from the handwriting perspective. So Just to make sure this is clear to everybody, so a lowercase theta is supposed to look like that, like a zero with a bar inside. An uppercase theta is supposed to look like that. It is a larger bar and the bar inside is thicker, and this is typically, if you do it in handwriting, denoted by such a bar with these little ends. So make sure that when you write notes, you always know which of the two thetas you refer to. So this is the space of parameters. So the uppercase thing, and this is one parameter, one particular parameter. Okay, so this is just, make sure you can always distinguish this. I hope I can manage to do it myself. So here what we now have in this family, we have this uppercase theta, that is the space, and then we have one particular parameter. So this is one particular parameter. Okay, so we just assume we can index our family of distributions by such a parameter theta, and this is then also called parametric statistics. Parametric statistics, I guess it's pronounced. Parametric statistics. There's also going to be non-parametric statistics, which we're going to see a bit later. So maybe I need to underline this. So parametric statistics, we have this. Okay, and now what I want, so we have this family of distributions, and this family is typically called a statistical model. The family F is called the statistical model. So this is a choice that you have to make. Say you want to estimate you want to make a statement about the height of the of people in Germany. Then you might say the height of people is normally distributed. Maybe that doesn't really fit completely because there is no negative height, for example. So you need to pick a family of distributions that as good as possible describes the random variable that you're interested in. And this is called your statistical model. This is a strong model assumption that goes into your statistical approach. And in traditional statistics, most of the statements are only true if your data is really being generated by an element of your statistical model. And this is, in this sense, it's really important to pick a good model and also to be aware that if you apply methods from traditional statistics, but you think your model assumptions are wrong, then you can't give any guarantees on what's going on. Okay, let's see. Let's go back. So we have the statistical model. Everybody in this model is identified by one particular parameter theta. And now we observe a sample. We draw, say, random people out of the population in Germany independently. And then we want to know which distribution generated this data. And in this particular case, the question of which is the correct distribution boils down to saying which is the parameter theta that actually generated, that is the correct parameter for our distribution. So we are given a sample x1 to xn. And the way I denote this now, it comes from some probability distribution f theta, so f theta might be the density, for example. But the key here is for one particular theta. Typically, this is IID. So identically distributed and independent. Of course, there's also statistics if this is not the case, but in the standard things that we are going to discuss, we assume the sample is IID. And theta is unknown. So we're given a sample, but theta is, or maybe I write the true parameter theta, the true underlying theta is unknown. And the goal of estimation, at least, point estimation, is to estimate this parameter. The goal of point estimation is to estimate theta. Okay, so you want to produce a function that estimates this. Now there's a bit of convention about notation that I want to introduce. Convention. So I've already said the parameter space is typically denoted by theta. So parameter space is this capital theta. And true parameter is typically denoted as theta, and either it's a true parameter or some unspecific member of the family, but the true parameter typically is denoted by theta. Then we write, and this is important, p theta and e theta. So this refers to the probability distribution that corresponds to the density given by theta, and also to the expectation. Refers to the probability and expectation under the distribution or density or whatever it is, density p theta. So the important thing here is really, maybe do it like this. This index here, so we have a whole family of distributions indexed by theta. And whenever I write p or p theta of something, I refer to the probability according to the distribution that has theta as a parameter. And in particular, with the expectation, you need to be a bit careful. Sometimes in conditional expectations, you write something like expectation e of x or so, which means you want to integrate over x, so you take the expectation with respect to x. This is not what is meant here. So theta is not a random variable. It's a, at least in frequentist statistics, it's just a parameter. It's a real number. Okay, so this is, so we have p theta, e theta. What else do we have? We have yet another convention. Typically in statistics, we write estimation, the estimate of a true parameter with a little hat. So this is the, so theta hat is the estimated parameter. So in statistics, these little hats always refer to estimators of the quantity theta in this case. Oh, and I see I should have written here f theta instead of p theta because I denoted it like this. Okay. Now let's maybe define formally what a point estimator is. Definition. So given a statistical model, model F, so I just write it now in its general form, F theta, theta in some parameter space, capital theta. And a sample x1 to xn, according to some element f in this particular model. Then we say a point estimator theta n hat. So I now denote the little n to index how many samples we have seen and the hat for the estimate of parameter theta is a function of the form we have theta n hat, which just is a function that takes all the samples, gn, g of x1 to xn, and it produces a real number. So this parameter is typically in R. So at least in the standard cases, the parameters, maybe they might be discrete, but now maybe let's think about a normal distribution and it might be the mean. Then a point estimate is, if the parameter is the mean, then the point estimate of the mean is just we observe a sample and estimate the mean by a function of the sample. So this function is a deterministic function. It takes the sample and spits out a number, and that's our estimate. Okay, so this is so far just a definition of a point estimator. And so far, I mean, this point estimator could be anything, and the way I've written it down here, it doesn't even have anything to do with theta. So obviously there will be some criteria to say how close the theta n is to theta. And there are two criteria that are important here. There's the bias of an estimator, and there's also the variance of an estimator. So let us try to define that. In black. So definition. The bias of such an estimator is defined as follows. Defined as now bias. So there is not really any abbreviation for that. Typically people write it like this. Of theta and ad. So the bias is a property of an estimate. And this is defined as, maybe I write it down, it's essentially defined as how far does this estimate in expectation deviate from the true parameter. Let me first write it down. E theta of theta n hat minus theta. Now let's try to decrypt that. So this is the true parameter. So theta, we don't know it, but in theory, of course, you can write it down. That's a true parameter. This is now the estimate. And now the important thing is here, we take the expectation under the probability distribution that corresponds to the true parameter. And this is really important because this is sort of the key thing that frequentist statistics does. So expectation with respect to the distribution, say f theta, if that's a density, the true one. So there is this true parameter theta, I don't know it, but this is the one that corresponds to my sample, say a normal distribution with mean 17. 17 is the true parameter, I don't know it, but I observe some sample. I estimate the mean of my sample, and maybe I get 17.5. And now I want to compare in expectation. If I repeat this experiment very often, I draw a sample and estimate. And then I take the average of what happens. This is essentially this, maybe I write this down in blue. This is this first term. So the intuition is repeat the procedure very often and average. So, and then you observe what you get on average. I mean often, I mean infinitely often. And then you compare the average of all your estimates with the true estimate. And this is what you call the bias. So the intuition is, if I would do this experiment very, very, very often, so infinitely often, because I take the true expectation, maybe I should write this better here, in very often, maybe I write infinitely often, very often, in parentheses, infinitely often, because I look at the true expectation. So I do this, I repeat the procedure infinitely often, and then and average over the estimate, theta n hat. So if I take again this example of the height of the population, I draw, I don't know, a sample of 50 people, look at the average height and take it as an estimate for the height of the population. Maybe I find 1.78 meters. I take another 100 people from the population, measure the height, and maybe observe 1.68 meters and so on. So I repeat this very often. And now I take the average over all these estimates. And then hopefully this is close to the true parameter, to the true height of the true mean of the population. And this is the bias. Okay. So the bias is the amount of deviation. And in particular, we say an estimate is unbiased if it has bias zero. An estimate is unbiased if its bias is zero. Zero. Unbiased. Okay. Now, when I learned statistics, I learned it, in fact, not from a statistics professor, but from somebody in probability theory a long time ago. Then people always, he always stressed that it is really cool if an estimate is unbiased, because on average, at least you find the correct result. From a theoretical point of view, that's true. However, I think one of the insights of statistics during the last, maybe already since a longer time, but maybe, I don't know when it started to happen, this insight, but is that in fact it's not always good to have unbiased estimates. In many cases, because there are two components, you need to have a look at the bias of the estimate, but also at a different component, the variance, and the sum of the two is what is important. So it is nice if an estimate is unbiased, but this is not the main goal we are striving for, and in particular, if you do real data analysis, often you're going to use estimates that are not unbiased. Okay, now the second term we want to look at is the variance of an estimate. So the variance roughly, I mean, it's really how far do these estimates jump around? So if I take a sample of 10 people from the population and average the mean height, and I do it again, how far on average are those going to be far apart? Like, is it that everybody is around 1.70 meters plus minus a few centimeters? Or could it be that once we have the average, 1 meter, and once we have the average 2 meters, so the spread is really wide? And the wider the spread is, the less reliable each individual estimate would be. And this is being measured by the variance. So now let's make this definition. The variance of an estimator is defined simply the way you would expect it as. So you take the variance with respect to the true parameter theta of the estimate theta n hat. So what does it mean? Let me first underline it, the variance of an estimator. So this expression here, variance with respect to theta, simply means I compute the variance. I mean, this theta n hat is just a random variable. We don't need to care about what it is. For any random variable, we can evaluate what it is variance. This is what we mean here. And we write this index theta to say we evaluate the variance with respect to the true underlying distribution, because this is the one that also generates the data. And even though we might not know it, this is going to be the variance of our estimate. So we observe some sample, we estimate the mean, and we can do this repeatedly, and then we can look at the variance of this guy. So this is the variance of an estimate. And now we have a quantity that's used very often in statistics, and it has its own name, namely this, essentially the standard deviation corresponding to this variance as a name. So the corresponding standard deviation, I mean, you know, the standard deviation is just the square root of the variance, is called the standard error and denoted by SE. And this is really a fixed term in statistics. The standard error and also this SE, that is a quantity everybody uses in applied statistics. So this is something you might want to know. Now, of course, this standard error is a quantity that, again, if we wanted to be able to compute, that we would need to know the underlying distribution, because we would need to know what theta is, and we don't know that. But, of course, we can estimate it from our sample, and then it gets a theta hat. So, typically, SE is unknown, but it can be estimated. And then the estimate of this quantity is SE hat. So that's now the standard convention, and I think it's a pretty useful convention. We have a true thing that we don't know, and the estimated thing about, estimated from our sample, receives a hat. So maybe I make an example here. Which one did I take? A Bernoulli random variable. That's sort of the simplest example you can take. You have xn to x, x1 to xn generated. So essentially it's coin tosses. With probability p, you receive head. With probability 1 minus p, you receive tail. So this is a Bernoulli, according to Bernoulli p. So p is now this parameter. So parameter p, and this is in 0, 1. And this is now what used to be this capital theta, right? So this is capital theta. And this, in this case, is the lowercase theta. Okay, so we know we have a coin, like whenever we throw it, it has the same probability p or 1 minus p to receive head or tail, but we don't know p, and now we might want to estimate it. And once we know p, we know everything about this underlying distribution. Now we can estimate it. So, and what is the way you estimate like the frequency of heads? You sample, and then you simply show on average I have received 5 heads out of 10. Then you would guess p is 1/2, and if on average you have received 3 out of 10, you would guess p is 3 over 10. Okay? So, and this is now the estimate we are going to use. So we use the estimate p n hat, which is simply defined as 1 over n sum I equals 1 to n xi. And maybe I should say one more word. So this x, so this Bernoulli random variable means, maybe just to make it sure, this is either 0 or 1, and 1 is with probability p. Okay, so by taking the sum, so these xi's are either 0 or 1, by taking the sum over the xi's, I essentially count how many 1's did I have. And then I normalize by n. So this is the frequency of the 1's I have observed. So this is an estimate. And now we can look at this estimate. So an estimate of p. Observe, I mean, this is sort of the most straightforward estimate we could have, and this is also more or less the only one that makes sense in this context. But in principle, you could have different estimates for the same quantity, because there might be different procedures by which you can estimate a certain quantity. And okay. And now, for example, if this is the case, you can look at the bias or the variance of the two. Now let's look at this. So to look at the bias, we now need to compute E P of P n hat. EP now means we compute the expectation under the assumption that the true parameter is P. Now what is that? So it is EP of, I just write and write the estimate, 1 over n sum I equals 1 to n xi. Now I can of course take out the sum and the scalar factor EP of xi. And now you know that the expectation of a Bernoulli random variable of one, like each of these xi's is now one Bernoulli random variable. This is a bit hard to read, it should be EP. Now this expectation is simply P. So what you get is P. Okay, so here maybe just to see, so this expectation yes, sorry, I was just confused about the 1 over n factor, but now I see it, it's obvious. So this expectation is p for each of the individual ones. We have the factor 1 over n, but then we also have the sum, we sum it n times, so these two things cancel, so the result is going to be p, very obvious. Sometimes I'm also confused by very simple things. Okay, now what does it mean? This is unbiased, because p is the true parameter, and now we have, this is exactly, if we go back to the definition of the bias, it is here. So the definition of the bias, so here's the bias. It says, compare the true parameter, p, to the expected value of your estimate, the expectation of pn in our case, pn hat, and take the difference between the two. And now we see that if we take the difference between this guy and the p, and the true p, then it's zero. So thus pn hat is unbiased, because maybe I just write it down once very explicitly. So the expectation of p in hat minus the true parameter p is just the same as p minus p, because we've just computed the first term that it's p and this is zero. So this is nice. And now we can also look at the variance and the standard error of this estimate. So the standard error of this estimate this is now given, I mean the standard error by definition is the square root of the variance, and I write it now very explicitly with respect to p of p n hat. And now p n hat is just a sum of n independent random variables. So we can take it out. So what we get is, this is 1 over n, the variance p of, say, the first random variable. And then this is the same as p 1 minus p. So the variance of a Bernoulli random variable is p times 1 minus p. And then we have this 1 over n here. Okay? So this is now the true standard error. And I'm going to make maybe a picture in a second. I just want to show you the estimated quantity. So this is the standard error that we don't know, and you can already see from the formula that we don't know it, because the p is unknown, right? But we can estimate it. We can, for example, estimate it by standard error hat, which is just now, I mean, we use what is called the plug-in estimator. If you have a formula in terms of, oh, that's not what I wanted to do, sorry. If we have a formula in terms of a true parameter and we don't know it, but we can estimate it, then we plug in the estimate of this true parameter in the formula, and this is called the plug-in estimate. So this is what we do here, pn 1 minus pn, sorry, pn hat, 1 minus pn hat over n. This is now an estimate of the standard error. Okay. And now one would need to look at these, of course, whether this estimate makes sense in the sense that these guys converge, like the standard error converges to the estimated standard error converges to the true standard error, and this is going to be true in this context, but this comes later. Okay, so far the example. So where are we? We have seen, first of all, I mean, an estimate is just a quantity we want to estimate from a sample. We can define the bias, which is on average how far does it deviate. And we have the variance, which is how much does these two things wiggle. And maybe I make a plot just to illustrate it. Example. Weight of babies. So assume you have a newborn baby and you measure its weight. The distribution of a weight of newborn babies in gram, for example. How do you write this in English? I don't know. In German we write it with two M's. I'm not sure whether gram and kilogram is going to be spelled with one or two M's. I'm going to check this in the end. So, but assume, I don't know, what is the average weight of a baby, say 2,900 grams. I really don't know. And say the distribution looks like this. So this is now the distribution of the weight of one baby. Weight of one baby. And this distribution has a certain mean. Say it is normally distributed, I mean, it's not perfectly normal, I'm clear about that, but assume we know the mean is maybe, I don't know, 2,900 grams, and the standard deviation is, or the standard deviation without the square, I don't know, is maybe 500 grams. I don't know. That seems to be a bit large, but maybe it's true. I mean, I didn't look up these numbers, okay? Just take it as an example. So the standard deviation essentially shows you how wide is the Gaussian, right? So the intuition is, I mean, if you go away from the from, this is just a rule of thumb, if you have your mean and you go away one standard deviation of the mean, this covers about 70% of your probability mass. I mean, this is just a rule of thumb. But this would be roughly in the sigma we've been talking, like in this particular image. And now we want to estimate it. So what we now do is we want to estimate the mean weight of babies. Now we want to estimate mean weight of babies. And how do we do it? We go to a hospital and we measure the weight of 100 newborn babies. Measure weight of, say, 100 babies. That's spelled not correctly, babies. Okay, and then what you might want to, what you might find is you might find, you do this once, and maybe you find, say 2,950 on average over these 100 babies, and maybe you do it a second time, and then you maybe find, I've read it. At the side, so maybe I remove the plot and then make the plot later. Do it a second time. Like again, taking 100 babies and taking the average, and maybe you observe 2,890 gram, and so on. And now, how is this distribution going to look like of all these estimates? So this distribution is going to be as follows. So you will have the 2,900, which is the true mean. And if you're on the same scale as above, this distribution is now going to be very pointed. And so this is now the distribution of the estimate mu n hat. So, and now what we observe is, because we have estimated over 100 babies, the variance of this estimate is already very small. So, and this is the standard deviation. So now here, if I make it again a bit larger maybe, sorry, so now we have here one standard deviation going left and right, and this is now the standard error, the width of this Gaussian here, that is now the standard error. And what you observe, and this is something you really need to digest, it's obvious once you've seen it, but maybe it takes a bit of time to get used to. So we start with this very wide Gaussian distribution about the original weight of babies, which is the distribution of the weight of one particular baby. Now if you look at the distribution of the weight of the average weight of 100 babies, this distribution gets narrower and narrower. And what is the reason for that? I mean, now think back to probability theory. The reason is, if you want the strong law of large numbers, or you can also say this is Hoeffding's inequality, if you might want to look at, we know that like if we average the weight of babies over more and more babies, eventually this estimate is going to converge to the true mean. And the true mean in this particular case is this 2,900. And the estimate is going to be closer and closer. And the likelihood that the estimate is far away from the true mean is getting smaller and smaller. And this is what you can see here. This is why the distribution of this estimate gets very narrow. Okay, and the important thing is now the standard error measures the width of the distribution corresponding to the estimate, not to the original distribution. Okay, what else? Now I've mentioned a couple of times that we have two measures that sort of tell us how good an estimate is. So we have the bias, and we also have the variance. And the variance may be observed that here, if you had an estimate whose variance would be much larger, then it wouldn't be really trustfully, because typically you just have one sample of 100 babies, so you see the estimate once. And if this estimate also has a wide distribution, then this estimate might not be close to the true estimate. So you want to have an estimate whose variance is small. And of course, you want to have an estimate whose bias is small, because otherwise you're never even going to converge on average. Okay. And now the quantity which we typically use to measure how close an estimate, like an actual estimate, is to the true parameter is the mean squared error. This is what people in statistics use quite a lot. And the reason why they use this a lot is because it has mathematically really nice properties. And one of them is then the bias variance decomposition that we're going to see in a minute. So I want to define now what is the mean squared error. So the mean squared error and this is always abbreviated as MSE, mean squared estimate, mean squared error, sorry, of an estimate is the quantity so MSE and now depending on the book people write arguments here or not. So this is your estimated parameter and your true parameter is the expectation again with respect to the true parameter of theta n hat minus theta squared. So essentially you look at the squared deviation between the estimate and the true parameter and then you do this in expectation over all possible parameters that you could get. This is because this notation is so misleading that it was wrong. You do it in expectation. Maybe it's important that this happened to me as well. The thing I'm talking about is here, this e theta. This expectation computes the expectation of the term on the right-hand side with respect to the probability distribution that corresponds to the true parameter. Okay? It is just one parameter, we don't know it, but this is a theoretical quantity. We want to know how close is our estimate to the true parameter, and we just say on expectation, so the expectation, maybe I can make this also clear here, the expectation here refers to this guy. This is a random variable. So this comes from the random sample, and that's the average mean, for example. So this is the guy we take the expectation over. The theta here is deterministic. And the expectation just says, look at all possible sample means that you could get by resampling. It is not what I just said before, because I didn't concentrate enough. Sometimes you, in the Bayesian approach, you might want to average over all possible parameters, theta, that might be the true parameters, but this is not true. And you've already seen the trap. I mean, I know this really, but sometimes if I don't concentrate and don't think about it closely, then I also make this mistake. Okay. Now, so this is the mean squared error. That's just one measure of error. You could have many other measures. You could look at the L1 error or the Kullback-Leibler divergence or whatever error you prefer, but this has a nice property, and that comes now, the bias variance composition. So, theorem, oops. Bias variance, maybe, decomposition. And this goes as follows. The mean squared error of an estimate theta n hat and the true parameter theta can be decomposed as bias of the estimate squared theta n hat plus variance with respect to theta, of course, of theta n hat. Okay, so this is really a cool theorem. Let me make a box around it. It is not difficult, but it is really useful. So the intuition is the MSE, the mean squared error, measures how good is our estimate, the current estimate on the sample we have. It doesn't make a statement about some artificial quantity or so. It says how good is your estimate in expectation. Okay. So how good is our estimate? How good is our estimate? In expectation and measured in the squared norm, of course. And now you can see, and the cool thing is now you can say this error measure of error consists exactly of two terms, and there's an equality sign here, which is really cool. And the two things you need to sum is the bias and the variance. And this gives you the error of your current estimate. And this is maybe also the point where you can see that being unbiased is not everything. So if you want to have an estimate that is good, you need to achieve that the bias is small and the variance is small. And now it could be that you find an estimate that is unbiased, but the variance is really, really large. And then you would need a huge amount of sample points before this variance goes down, hopefully to zero. But maybe if you trade a bit between the two, so there's a trade-off, it might be that there's a better estimate. It might have a small bias, so it's not unbiased. But maybe the variance of this other estimate is much smaller, and then the sum of the two is smaller. And so the quantity you need to control, at least if this is a loss function you're interested in, is now the sum between the squared bias and the variance. And because this is just such an important theorem, and its proof is just so simple, I want to give you the proof here. Proof. So let us start writing it down. So the quantity we want to look at is the mean squared error. So it's expectation of theta n hat minus theta squared. And now I do something here that I also find very important. So in textbooks, typically you see the statement without these outer parentheses. They just write e of theta n hat minus theta squared. And then I find it always confusing whether the square is inside the expectation or whether you square the whole expectation. And this is why I make a point of putting parentheses, lots of parentheses, but to make sure that this notation is not ambiguous. And I encourage you to do the same, because even when I prepared this lecture and tried to read up the proof in a book, I first of all thought the proof was wrong because I got confused by the notation. So do put these parentheses. So what is this now? We already know by definition. Not by definition. What we do is we do now a little trick. Let me first write it down. So I'm going now to insert and subtract again a term. I just write it down. Theta n hat minus expectation of theta n hat plus expectation of theta n hat minus theta squared. So what happened here is these two terms, I have minus expectation plus expectation, this is just zero, so I didn't change it. And these two terms are the ones I had before. So far I haven't really changed anything. And now essentially I want to multiply it out, and I use the binomial formula. And just to show you what are the two terms I'm going to look at, let's call this a and b. So if you have the formula, you say it's a plus b squared is a squared plus 2 times a times 2ab plus b squared. This is now what we're going to do. So we leave the expectation. Oh, and maybe one more remark. Here now there are lots of expectations in all these formulas. All of them are meant to be expectation with respect to the parameter theta. I sometimes now drop it because otherwise it gets a bit messy. So now we have this term, and now what do we do? So we first square the first term. Theta n hat minus e of theta n hat squared. And that's the first term. Plus, and now we have, oh, and I already take the expectations apart because expectation is a linear operator, so I can take the expectation out. Expectation of theta n hat minus e theta n hat times e theta n hat minus theta, and there's a 2 missing. Now let's see, just to check whether I made a typo. So the first term is a, this is this guy, and the second term is b, it's this guy, and there's this factor 2. Okay, and now I need to look at the third term plus, I hope I can squeeze it in here. This is now e theta n hat minus theta squared, like this. This is b squared, okay? So far nothing has happened really. And now there's an interesting thing here. We now look at this term here. And this is a deterministic term. So by deterministic I mean it's not a random variable. And why is that true? Theta is a parameter, this is not a random variable anyways. And now here we have the expectation of a random variable, which again is just a real number. There's nothing random about an expectation. So this is just a real number, And if I have an expectation of a times a random variable, I can pull out the a. So this real number I can take out. So I can pull it out. So this whole guy here, what does it get? It is now 2. Now I pull out this term, e theta n hat minus theta. That's the term, the deterministic term. And then I have still the remaining e theta of theta n hat minus e theta n hat. Okay, and now there's another cool thing that happens. This guy, if you look at it. So the second part here, this e theta n hat, is again a real number. And this is the random variable. So if I have expectation of a random variable minus a real number, I can take it apart. So this is the same as e theta of theta n hat minus e theta n hat. And now maybe I put the theta here. So this is 0. Because if you look at it, these are two times the same expression. So this is 0. So this whole term which we have in the middle here is 0. It disappears completely. Quite convenient. So now we can assemble what we are left with. So now I start from here. And so now we're just left with this term and with the term here in the very end. So let's write it down. E theta of theta n hat minus e theta n hat squared plus, and now the term that's at the end in the last line, e of theta n hat minus theta squared. Okay, and now again we can do one of these tricks. So this inside here is also a deterministic quantity. So it's a constant because theta is a constant and the expectation is a constant. So we can, in fact, drop the e here. So this is just the same as, I mean, this whole expression is just the same as e of theta n hat minus theta squared. Okay, and this is the bias. Squared. This is exactly like the, so this is bias squared of theta n hat. If you look back to the definition, this is exactly how far does the, or maybe I write it differently, sorry, I mean maybe just to make sure I also, so this is bias of theta n hat squared. This is also what I meant in the theorem when I wrote bias squared. Okay. Now the first term, if you look at it closely, that's just the variance. So here, this is the variance of theta n hat. Because what is the variance? The variance, you look at the random variable, you subtract its mean, and you look at the squared deviation. That's the variance of a random variable. And there we go. That's our bias variance decomposition, now just written in the other order. So what we started with is the mean squared error, and we obtained it is variance plus bias squared. That's cool, isn't it? It's really simple, but it's a powerful and very important theorem. Now I realize that this lecture is going to get a bit long. But still, I think I might, it's one more page. I want to show you at one example again this thing of looking at the mean squared error with respect to bias and variance in this unbiasedness. So let's look at one more example here. Example. And the example is we have a normally distributed random variable and we want to estimate its mean or its variance. So the statistical model that we look at is the one of normal distributions, mu sigma, where mu can be any real number, and sigma can be any positive real number. Now, observe, so this is our sample. This was our model. normal distributions. The sample is x1 to xn is going to be produced according to some n mu sigma with unknown mu and sigma. Sorry, sigma squared I need to write. With unknown mu and sigma squared. And we also assume that the sample is IID. Okay, that's sort of the standard assumption. Sometimes if I forget it, just think it in the back of your mind. And now we want to estimate mu and sigma because these are the parameters that we're interested in. So the obvious estimate for mu is the sample mean, 1 over n sum of xi, I from 1 to n. This is the obvious estimate of the sample mean. And this is an unbiased estimate. We've already seen that essentially before. You can write it down in one line. If you take the expectation on the left side and on the right side, you will see immediately that in the IID setting, you get the original expectation back. So this is an unbiased estimate of mu. So that's all nice. Now we want to look at the estimate of the variance. Now I write down the first estimate of the variance, sigma 1, how did I denote it, hat square, which I just define as 1 over n, sum xi minus mu hat square, I from 1 to n. So this is the typical plug-in estimate for the variance. And maybe I just write the two a bit nicer so you can really read it. Yeah, so maybe this. Now it's not nicer again. Sigma 1 hat square. So sigma 1 and sigma 2 are going to be two different estimates. That's why I have a 1. The square is because we typically write this parameter as a square and we look at the variance and the hat comes from the estimate. Now what I have here is the plug-in estimate. So plug-in in the sense that we like when you compute the sample mean, the sample variance, you need to look at the difference between the sample points and the empirical mean. So ideally we would like to have the true mean here, but we don't know it, so we use the estimated mean here. Okay. So this is one estimate. And I also want to show you another estimate, and maybe I write it in a different color, sigma 2 hat squared, which is nearly the same, just we have 1 over n minus 1 sum. I equals 1 to n xi minus mu hat square. So the only difference between the two estimates is that one estimate is scaled with 1 over n. That's the naive thing you might want to do. And the other is going to be scaled with 1 over n minus 1, which is not the naive thing, but we're going to see that this might be a good choice. We see it in the end. And now we can, of course, look at the variance of these estimates. So, variances. So I start with computing, or maybe first of all, the bias of the estimates. So I look at the expectation of the first estimate, sigma 1 square. And if you do the math, what you're going to find is, this is n minus 1 over n times sigma square, where sigma is now the true parameter. So here, this is the true parameter. And now ideally for an unbiased estimate, what you might want to have is you might want to get the true parameter back. So ideally we would like to get that the expectation of this estimate is sigma squared. But now we see here's a little deviation. So this term that we have here, maybe I just make an exclamation mark, this is not 1. It's n minus 1 over n. So this is unbiased. It's not unbiased, has a bias. So the variance, and the headline variance is here is maybe not, I just drop it. So let's compute, I write it. Let's compute. So the bias, the bias is 1 over n sigma squared. So on average, this estimate of the variance is by a factor of 1 over n off. Okay. Now we can do the same for this other estimate, for the sigma 2.
sigma 2 hat squared. Oh, and here I forgot the hat. Now its expectation, if you do the math, is going to be sigma squared. So this is unbiased. Okay, and that's a bit surprising if you see it for the first time. If you have seen it already, it's not so surprising anymore. But the funny thing is, like, to estimate the variance, if you use the naive one with a factor 1 over n, that's what everybody would start with, including myself. If you don't know it, that's the estimate you write down. You receive this factor n minus 1 over n. And if you start with this other normalization here, 1 over n minus 1, instead of 1 over n, then you receive an unbiased estimate. Okay? Okay, and maybe I didn't write down the whole computation, how you do that, that's just one line, maybe do it as an exercise here. Now, what we've seen are now the biases. Now let's look at the variances of the two estimates. So the variance of the first estimate, and again, I'm not going to write down the whole computation, this is simple, you can just do it, is 2n minus 1 sigma to the power of 4 over n squared. And the variance of sigma 2 squared hat is going to be, if you do the math, 2 sigma to the power of 4 over n minus 1. So these are just the formulas. And now you can compute the mean squared errors. So the mean squared error of the first guy, sigma 1 hat square, is now, we know that, that's the bias, square plus the variance. Now, what is it in the first term? You can again write it down to do the sum of these two terms. And what you're going to find is, I just write it at the end here, 2n minus 1 over n squared times sigma to the power of 4. And if you do the same for this other estimate, MSE of sigma 2 squared, then what we're going to find, again with the bias variance decomposition, that we find 2n over n minus 1 sigma 4. And now if you compare these two numbers, you can see that sigma 1 has a smaller mean squared error even though it's biased. So if you compare these numbers, sigma 1 is going to be smaller or equal than sigma 2. So what we can conclude is sigma MSE of sigma 1 hat is smaller than the mean squared error of sigma 2 hat. Even though the sigma 1 is biased and the sigma 2 is not biased, but the variance sort of terms compensate for that, and in the end it's still, if you want to have an estimate that has a small mean squared error, you need to use the first one, the naive one. Which is maybe a bit reassuring that the naive thing in the end turns out to be the good thing again. Okay. So that's the last example I want to make, and now there's just one more definition and then we're going to conclude this part of the lecture. I just want to say, what does it mean that an estimate is consistent? A point estimate or estimator theta n hat of theta is consistent or strongly consistent. These are two different notions. If theta n hat converges to theta in probability, or maybe I do it in fact in blue, almost surely. Almost surely refers to strongly consistent. I do it in colors, then it's easier to distinguish. Strongly consistent. Okay, an estimator is consistent if it converges to the correct thing. And this is the notion we want to have. So in the very beginning I said an estimate is just a function of the sample, and of course, like the way we defined it in the beginning, it could have been any function. But here is what is now important. We're interested in estimates that are consistent. And consistent means that the estimated quantity, as n goes to infinity, maybe I should write this as n goes to infinity, So it converges in probability S n to infinity.
So the more and more sample we observe, the better the estimate should be. And this is a notion that is, of course, really important in statistics. If you want to measure the treatment of a new vaccine for a new disease, maybe you first measure it on 10 people and you already see it looks good. Then you measure it on 100 people. Then you measure it on 1,000 people. And then you measure it on 50,000 people. And this is exactly what the experimental trials, also the medical trials, do. You have this phase 1, phase 2, and phase 3. So you always extend your sample. And once you've observed it on, I don't know, 50,000 people, because the mean is a quantity that is typically consistent, the mean estimate, so then we can conclude that the true effect of this new drug is very, very, very close to what we have measured, and ultimately it's going to converge to the right thing. So this is the kind of estimate that we wanted to have. And interestingly, like if you have a statistical estimate that is not consistent, you essentially throw it away, you cannot use it. In machine learning, it turns out that many of the algorithms that we use in everyday, if you look at them more closely, many of them or some of them are not consistent. And this is maybe, as a side remark, one of my fields of research, to look at consistency of machine learning algorithms. It's a bit of a more complicated notion, but the insight is the same. If I or the intuition, if I observe more and more and more sample points, ultimately I want that the outcome of my algorithm should converge to the true outcome, to the true underlying thing. And if that's not the case, even if I observe millions of sample points and it's going to converge to something else, then maybe we shouldn't use that algorithm. So this consistency notion is really one of the fundamental concepts, both in statistics but also in machine learning, of course. And now just the opposite thing. Typically what you want, like we looked at the mean squared error, because for example if the mean squared error goes to zero, then we get consistency, and we also get it if both the bias and the variance converge to zero. That's also pretty obvious, and I just want to write it down and then we finish with this lecture. So theorem: if an estimate satisfies that the bias goes to zero and the standard error goes to zero, so essentially the variance goes to zero, Sn to infinity, then the estimate is consistent. And the proof is obvious. If the bias goes to zero and the standard error goes to zero, the mean squared error goes to zero. The mean squared error is essentially convergence in L2. If you think about the notions of convergence of random variables, we had in probability almost surely, and in L1, L2, and so on. So mean squared error going to zero means the L2 error goes to zero, and convergence in terms of L2 implies convergence in probability, and then we have consistency. Okay, so this concludes the first lecture, where we've seen what an estimate is, and then two important notions to evaluate about such an estimate are the bias and the variance. And if we get a grip on both of them, and both of them are small, then hopefully, or like under the conditions of the theorem, we get a consistent estimate, and we know at least if we observe enough sample points, our estimate is going to be correct. And this is, of course, a nice property.